My name is Sandra Roach. I'm a postdoctoral researcher here in the NICB. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about some of the pancreatic cancer work that we're doing here. So Dr. O'Neill has already kind of alluded to the fact that pancreatic cancer is not a nice disease. 5 years post-diagnosis, the survival rate is approximately only 7%. There are limited therapeutic improvements over the last 40 years for this disease. So this graph, taken from Pancreatic Cancer Action charity in the UK, shows that for solid tumours, over the last 40 years, most solid tumours have seen an increase in patient survival. This is pancreatic cancer at the bottom. So there has been very limited improvement for this disease. So the treatment options for pancreatic cancer are similar to most solid cancers. Surgery is the only cure, but only if the disease is caught at a very early stage. The surgery itself is a very robust, a very tough surgery for the patients. And it is only possible if the disease is very small and still localized within the pancreas. Chemotherapy, or the use of drugs, can be used pre-surgery to help shrink the tumour to make the patient more suitable for surgery. It can be used post-surgery to remove any cells that are left or any cells that are not evident to the surgery. And it can also be used where surgery is not possible to improve the patient's quality of life. Radiotherapy, as Dr. O'Neill talked about already, is the use of high energy rays to kill or control cancer cells. This can also be used pre or post surgery, and it can also be used to help control pain or bleeding. So in Ireland, pancreatic cancer surgery is centralised to two hospitals, the St. Vincent's Hospital in Dublin and Cork University Hospital. Adjuvant treatment and follow-up can be done at any of the local cancer centres. We're very fortunate to have fantastic collaboration with St. Vincent's University Hospital with the surgical team and the pathology unit in St. Vincent's. And that has helped us to start a patient-derived xenograft program here in DCU. So a patient-derived xenograft is basically a mouse model of a human tumour. There are many mouse models used in tumour biology. There are cell line derived xenografts where you take human cells that you would normally grow in the lab and implant them into an animal. This is used when because the material is readily available or because the lab findings can then be replicated and expanded to look at in a 3D and a more complete system. The disadvantage of this is it fails to generate the tumour architecture. It fails to generate what Denison has described, which is all of the other cells that happen inside of a tumour, not just the tumour cells. Genetically engineered mouse models are where you breed mice that have a particular genetic mutation that cause the tumour to develop innately within the mouse. The advantage of this is if you're looking at immune therapies and therapies that rely on an immune system, these animals have a full, complete immune system. It is a very expensive system to look at. And the disadvantage as well is that you're looking at a mouse tumour within a mouse. What we're interested in and what we do is we're looking at patient-derived xenografts. So this is where we take a patient sample and we implant it into an animal to grow and expand the tumour. The main advantage of this is it maintains the patient tumour architecture. So as the tumour grows in the mouse, it looks the same as the tumour that came from the patient. The big disadvantage of it is that the animals have to have no immune system for this to work. So you can't look at work like Dennis is looking at, where you're looking to see how the immune system works on the tumour. So what we do is we take a piece of tumour from post-surgery. So once a patient has had a surgery, we get a piece of the tumour. And that's rapidly transferred across the city and implanted in here in DCU into a skid mouse, so a mouse that has no immune system. We then allow that to grow, and that can take anywhere between 3 months to a year. And once the tumour has grown, then we will remove the tumour and we will save it, so cryopreserve it, so that we can use it again at a later date for other experiments. We take bits then that we can look at protein and gene levels. We try to do as much with it as possible. We take samples that are formal fixed and paraffin embedded. So our aims are to try establish a living biobank. We're also trying to make the most out of this limited material, so we derive cell lines from it. And one of the key things is that we go back to the hospital, we go back to St. Vincent's and ask them to double check that what we've grown is actually the same as the original patient, because if it's not, it's of no use to us. So because our primary material that we got from the hospital is very precious, we try to do as much with it as possible. So as well as implanting it, where possible, we try to take a small bit of that and freeze it very quickly so that we can use it for looking at protein levels, looking at gene levels. We also try to take a small bit and try to get that to grow on plastic so that we can generate what are stromal cells, these other cells that are inside the tumour, to see so we can look at the other cells and not just the tumour cells. So to date we've been very fortunate. We've had 42 samples and we've had a pretty good success rate in getting them to grow. 27 of them have been a particular type of pancreatic cancer that we're interested in. There have been other types of cancers that we've gotten, and the reason behind that is we get the sample as fresh as possible, so we don't get the diagnosis until a couple of days later. So we'll take whatever we can get, and we get other diseases that are not the pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma that we're interested in. So some of the things that I mentioned is one of the things we look at is primary cell culture. So this is where you take the cells out of the tumour after the tumour has grown in the mouse to try generate tumour cells out of that. And so we digest it and try to release the cells and then expand it. And the reason behind this is because doing baseline basic science in cells is ethically much more viable than doing it in animals, and it's cheaper, and you can look at very specific questions. So we're looking to see how are these cells different to cell lines that we've had growing for 40 and 50 years. These cells are closer to what the original patient cells are. And so we want to look at some of the standard of care chemotherapy drugs and see what the differences of these drugs are in these cell lines. And so just to kind of give you a very quick snapshot of what we're doing here. So one of the things that has really helped this program is that with cancer surgery, pancreatic cancer surgery being centralized, it has really assisted us getting a critical number of samples from the hospital that we can try to develop these models. These models are incredibly valuable. They can be used for multiple different biobanks. They provide patient-relevant material. And they're a fantastic source for many different projects and many different areas of research. The development of the primary cell lines we've shown is possible and results in material for our basic lab investigations without having to go back and do work on more animals. As with anything, none of us work on our own. It couldn't be done without a team. We're particularly grateful to St. Vincent's Hospital, to St. Luke's Hospital, to Science Foundation Ireland, everyone else who pays us, and to everyone who helps. Anyone have any questions? I'm more than happy to keep talking.